Dr. Winter is a physician, and she does internal medicine, and she started her practice in the early 80s. In fact, one of the amazing things about her, as I mentioned briefly this morning, is that she is one of the physicians that first encountered AIDS. And it's through that encounter that she was able to move into Africa. And from her life work, she has composed, not entirely life work, but from her experience as a physician, doing concrete activism, she's going to talk to us today about Africa. Thank you very much, and please welcome Professor Adama.
So thank you, Kristen. And as he said, I do not belong at all at the world of the university. So that work I will read here is a kind of self-ordered work and is a kind of sermon of my experience, first of all with my passion coming from Africa for about 20 years. And also, as he said, the experience of activism about what happens in Africa and how it begins. Okay. So, as you will see, it's a kind of propaganda also for the kind of works which is politics. That means extra work for free, because what Alain was describing in the morning, the process of subjectivity and so on, it's a matter in real life of extra work, I think. So it's an example of extra work. As upon the occasion of writing this paper, it was the intervention of France in Central Africa. So it's what shaping the paper. And third, a kind of work, politics works, extra works, doesn't have a place. So he has to find his place. So today, he found his place here. So thank you. So now I begin. So the title is Reviving Pan-Africanism. First, returning to the ancestors. Not for nothing did they want African unity, and to begin with, big states. Not for nothing were they all prevented from achieving these goals. The country called Centrafrique, or the Central African Republic, is in agony. Barthélemy Boganda, who ought to have become the country's first president, did not call what is today the Central African Republic, Centrafrique. What he understood by that name, rather, was a country comprising what is today the so-called Central African Republic, formerly Ubangi-Chari, but also the Congo-Brazzaville, Gabon, and Chad. All countries visited in a single day last January 2 by the French Defense Minister. We shall return to this. Boganda wrote, I quote, if Ubangi-Chari had to achieve independence on its own someday, this would be a catastrophe. So Barthélemy Boganda died in a well-organized helicopter accident in March of 1959. Once he had been eliminated, the dismemberment of the territories proceeded in accordance with the wishes of France. Why is that history, in particular this history, that of the first wave of the African struggle for liberation from the colonial yoke and for independence? Why is it so carefully erased? These days, the Central African Republic has the honor of appearing in the newspapers. We shall see how. In these articles, the name of Boganda never appears. On the part of the colonial rags that are the French dailies as a whole, this is perfectly normal, you will say. Yes. But what of the radicals, the progressives, the activists, those outside the system and so on, the people with a higher degree of consciousness and so forth? None of that even exists, you will say. Maybe. You will begin to exist once you have learned to put up. This is a thesis that we do not hesitate to propose. And conversely, dear comrades here and there who are protesting or who are troubled, how can you let yourselves be cut off from yesterday's history, from that which concerns you above all? How can you let yourselves live only in the present moment? Let us pick it up again. That is our only watchword. Let us pick up again the thread of history there where it was broken. What were the questions? What were the watchwords? How were we defeated? How should we pick up the cause again? Here is a quotation from the French poet Saint John Perse. Let us pick up the long debate where we left off. And you may urge your arguments like snouts now over the water. I will leave you no rest and no respite. But first, before speaking potentially internally to those who will join us, let us pause for everyone else as well on the Central African Republic. Let us read the imperialist rags for them. We must know how to read them closely, in other words, how to call them into question. Le Monde, the French number one colonial rag, tells us the story of Jotodia's deposition. He was forced to resign on January 10th after 2 days of discussion in N'Djamena, the capital of Chad. Here's the story the newspaper tells in its edition of January 10th, 2014. Idriss Déby, the president of Chad, receives Jean-Yves Le Drian, the French minister of defense, on January 1st. In other words, a full month after the deployment of the French Sangaris forces, a month during which Chadian soldiers are patrolling with the French. Idriss Déby wants to depose Jotodia after the latter announces a plan of partition for the north of the Central African Republic. Certain compensations, the article tells us, I quote, have been exchanged with the principal military partner of France. Le Drian, the France defense minister, reaffirms his confidence in Idriss Déby, France's perfect, I quote, perfect military ally in Mali. On the day of January 2, Le Drian goes to Bangui, then to Brazzaville, to consult with Sassou Nguesso, then to Ali Bongo in Gabon, then back to N'Djamena that same evening, just as Jotodia is arriving there, summoned by Déby. On January 3, Jotodia's resignation is announced. So there you have it, a deal briskly conducted by the two good Franco-Chadian friends, and the story in Le Monde dutifully congratulates itself on it. But then, why wait a month after the arrival of Sangaris to depose Jotodia, while murders and other horrors are peeling up, and without a single gesture in the direction of disarming the notorious Sangaris, the notorious Seleka. But that isn't all. The Seleka was formed in August of 2012. For months, its commandos, composed especially of Chadian and Sudanese mercenaries, advanced toward Bangui, leaving as they go a path strewn with destruction, looting, arson, murder, and rape. None of this in any way troubles France, which, incidentally, has nothing to say about it to its perfect Chadian ally. Djotodia takes power in Bangui in March of 2013. Still no complaints. The lootings, the murders, violent acts of all kinds continue. Horrors keep piling up. Things still remains for the best for the Franco-Chadian friends. So, wasn't this Djotodia omen, as people there believe, in view of the oil recently discovered in the north of the country, and which is coveted by the Chinese, among others? Wasn't the former president perfectly corrupt and calamitous, by the way, therefore perfectly suitable for the rest of us, having had the weakness to request comparative studies before the exploitation of the oil fields? But doesn't France have a birthright there, which would explain its policy of Benin understanding, to say the least, for the notorious Seleka? Or should we believe that what is happening there is a sudden rise in temperature in this country where Christians, who are 80% of the population, and Muslims had been living side by side without any problems? Is this just a case, as another French newspaper writes, L'Express, put it blandly, of, I quote, sense of ordinary hatred? Ordinary strikes us as particularly sickening. Since the seizure of power by the Seleka, 1 million people have had to flee their homes, this in a country of 4.7 million. Nonetheless, we indeed read that it is the threat of secession on the part of the country's north, where the oil is, that frightened Idriss Déby, already grappling with the Darfur business and the secession of the neighboring South Sudan. And is there ever an end to the carving up into oil concessions controlled by mercenaries? We also understand, at the moment at which this text is being written, that is January, February this year, that the Djotodia card has not been entirely abandoned by the Franco-Chadian accomplices. As his lieutenant has stated, I quote, negotiations are still going on. Everything depends on what spare parts are available. Otherwise, wouldn't this torch, having become useless, have been handed over for punishment to so-called international law, instead of which he was allowed to go and settle in Benin? For a comparison, let us consider the fate that was reserved for the former president of the Ivory Coast, Laurent Gbagbo, at the time of his arrest by the French military in April of 2011. He was indeed delivered to the famous international court and has remained imprisoned in The Hague since November of 2011. Last June 2013, a preliminary hearing took place whose purpose was not to judge him, but to determine whether or not there were in fact grounds for a trial. The court ruled that the incriminating evidence presented by the prosecutor was insufficient grounds for a trial. According to what has been said among people of the Ivory Coast, the prosecution made a film intended to prove the violent acts committed by Gbagbo, But the defense was able to prove that this film was in fact a montage filmed in another country than the Ivory Coast, which even in this proceeding would have made a bad impression. The prosecution appealed, but the court confirmed its decision on appeal and asked the prosecution to provide it by November 2013 with more substantial evidence that would allow it to rule on the possibility of a trial. The prosecution appealed this decision concerning the time it was wanted, and the judge suspended the deadline. So the prosecutor therefore has a free hand to pursue her investigation indefinitely. In contrast, the imprisonment of Gbagbo, which is supposed to be reviewed every 120 days, has just been confirmed again. In case you are still a little puzzled, in the meantime, there has been an editorial in the newspaper Le Point entitled, I quote, "The Central African Republic, the Risk of Partition." And it begins with a photograph caption, "Former Seleka rebels are escorted out of Bangui by Sangare soldiers." No doubt about it, in the photograph in question, the so-called rebels are displaying their rifles and guns. In no way are they disarmed. After which, the article seriously considers the risk of secession. In this, I quote, "hemmed in remote region bordering Chad and the Sudan." The region, the article continues, is extremely poor but potentially rich. It contains still unexploited diamond mines and oil fields for which the license was granted to a Chinese company, China National Petroleum Corporation, in 2010. By the ex-president François Bozizé. So here we are. This wasn't just a threat, it was a work in progress. Whence the Selikian emergency. The article continues, I quote, "A partition of the Central African Republic would be too dangerous for Chad. But, I quote again, more than a partition, the risk in the north of the Central African Republic is the development which the arrival of the Seleka rebels of a region increasingly cut off from Bangui, one that would be self-managing, a vast black hole in the heart of Africa, adjacent to the Darfur region of the Sudan, in which the rebels from the entire area would be living together. In short, a golden opportunity for all the jihadist groups that are swarming there." End of the quotation. And thus, for our oil tycoons too, not a single state, not even the most embryonic kind of one, to stick its nose into their business. From offshore to offshore, we proceed directly from the African black hole to the European or American tax haven without spilling a drop, with everything necessary right there in terms of armed bands to be corrupted, paid, and employed as mercenaries. Exactly as we are now doing in the north of Mali. This is why our soldiers are busy escorting the ex-Seleka armed with their guns. Of course, the human cost is rather high. We are talking about nothing less than ethnic cleansing for up until now in the Central African Republic, Christians and Muslims had been living together. I quote again, "Muslims form only 15% of the population of the Central African Republic. A majority in the north of the country, they are now being joined by those people of the Central African Republic who are fleeing Bangui and the central cities to escape from the massacres by the anti-Balaka Christian militias. It is therefore rather difficult to bring this operation to a successful conclusion, which is why Olam needs more troops, why he has appealed for help from his European neighbors, and so forth. All the while having a bit of trouble explaining what exactly is at stake. This then is the Central African Republic, 1 million out 4.7 million people living as refugees. It's this, now I quote my patient's words. I went there to see and help my family, who are with thousands of people living in refugee near a church. I haven't been able to meet with them, neither to bring them anything. There's no water, and people talk about epidemics. All I've seen is how people I knew have grown emaciated in just a few weeks, since they can no longer go to work and have nothing to eat. It's this, another quotation. Entire families, including old people, women, and children, have their throats cut in their homes. It's this again. My family took refuge near the airport. My brother wanted to go and see how our house was. He was killed. And again, yesterday, Saturday, February 1st, it's this. My aunt sent her son to look for water. There isn't any in their neighborhood. He was killed on the way. End of the quotation. So the promoters irresponsible for these massacres and for this cataclysm ought to be looked for in Paris. So let us stop here on the French side. You will begin to exist once you have learned to put Africa at the center of your world, we say. Yes. Because colonial complicity has been the gangrene of French society for a century now, and has brought it to the state of advanced rottenness, of mental and moral disintegration, of the paralysis and lifelessness that everyone enjoys deploring nowadays. Deploring is one thing. Getting out of this state is another. Colonial complicity is the inherent mode of French society's membership in and consent to the imperialist world order. And we think it is the very basis of that passion for ignorance that subjugates this society, this entire society, from the hideouts of the intellectuals to the most distant suburban housing projects. The disintegration of the French Communist Party and consequently the complete disappearance of French workers from the Seine was the price of the dishonorable behavior of this party during the war in Algeria. But since then, matters have gone from bad to worse. Speaking of colonialism in the past tense, declaring that one is living in the post-colonial and so on, turning it into a mere subject for history books, these are signs and symptoms of that profound complicity that feeds the passion for ignorance. The Central African Republic is today, Brazzaville is today, the de facto partition of Mali is today, the repercussion of the destruction of Libya are today, and so on and so forth. If this is happening, it's because everyone accepts Everyone goes along with a situation in which some people can die so that others, we others, can continue in the security of their being. In other words, the motto of a Boganda, that is Zokwezo, that means every man is a man, exactly the same as that of Aristide in Haiti, Tumun Semun, that means every man is a man and everyone belongs to the world, is indeed the heart of the matter. Complicity consists in going along with the denial, as if self-evident, of this basic assertion, of which we are no longer even obliged to be aware. This, moreover, is precisely the meaning and function of the unspeakable bullshit known as the humanitarian ideology. So, what is at stake here is that you, who are potential reader of this text, might decide in yourself, indeed even only for yourself, in your soul and in your consciousness. Yes or no? Should French newspapers, and among them in first place the Nobel Monde, be called nauseating colonial rags? Yes or no? Should the celebrated International Penal Court be called STI, that is stinking tool of imperialism? Yes or no? Should the word humanitarian be systematically bracketed together with the modifier unspeakable? Or are these just excesses on the part of the author of this text, whose ardor one understands and even forgives, but by which sophisticated people, in the fairness and level-headedness of their judgment, avoid getting carried away? It is very much a wish that, even without going further, you agree to ask yourself the question, indeed to do a little investigating on your own side for yourself. And if you should ever arrive at the conclusions that we also have reached, we wish that, for yourself, you might not forget the modifiers above, even when, like everyone and all of us, you read Le Monde or contribute to some humanitarian enterprise. And then we wish that you might even make your feeling known to some of those around you when the subject is mentioned, and so forth. That really isn't insignificant. There will already be that. One must separate oneself, so separate yourself. Okay. Having said this, let us pick up the thread from the inside. Let us pick up the thread as activists. Once, the great ancestors speak of unity and pan-Africanism. Is this just a case of cultural coquettishness, as we can read on the websites of international institutions today? Not at all. The ancestors think that there must be big states without which there is no way to defeat colonialism. They think that it is necessary to combat, above all, ethnic, territorial, familial, and tribal divisions. Barthélemy Boganda wants a true Central African state, that is what is today the Central African Republic, Chad, Gabon, and Congo-Brazzaville, as the first step toward the United States of Latin America. Lumumba fights inside the Congolese national movement against federalism, and the Congolese national movement will split into two over this question in 1959. He has to deal with the centrifugal tendencies of Joseph Kasavubu's Abaco in the Bakongo region, but also in the other regions. His struggle is for the unity of the Congo. Going against this struggle, the imperialist, as we know, stir up secessionism as soon as independence is proclaimed. The Union of the Peoples of Cameroon, whose watchword is independence and the reunification of the country, takes the utmost care in all its proceedings and all its committees to mix cadres from the different regions of the country. France, of course, plays one region off against another, especially the north against the south. Kwame Nkrumah, the president of the first independent African state, writes, I quote, writes the book, Africa must unit. His goal, too, is the United States of Africa. He attempts a union with the Guinea of Sékou Touré before being deposed by a coup d'etat and having to take refuge in Guinea as a private individual. Modibo Keita proposes a union with Niger and Senegal, which Senghor Senegal opposes. Later, after he has been deposed by a coup d'etat, Sékou Touré's Guinea proposes a union to his successor Moussa Traoré, but this time it is Traoré who refuses. Boganda and Lumumba are assassinated. France begins a decade of bloody war to destroy the Union of the Peoples of Cameroon. Nkrumah and Keita are deposed by coup d'etat. Later, Amilcar Cabral, commanding the liberation struggle of Guinea-Capo Verde, is assassinated thanks to the stirred up jealousy between the peoples of Guinea and Capo Verde. As a result, there is no longer a single country, but rather two pieces, Guinea-Bissau and Capo Verde, in accordance with the wishes of, above all, behind Portugal, the Americans, in order to keep their military base on Capo Verde. So the first question to decide is this: were the ancestors white or not? It seems clear to us that the future, that is our present, has only shown and shows every day how white they were. You need big states to oppose imperialism and colonialism. And for that, it is absolutely imperative to be able to overcome the division and ethnicization that colonialism, for its part, is constantly working to cultivate. I quote again, wanting to create little specks of states in the 20th century is a retrograde policy whose result will be the disappearance in short order of these very states and the loss of their independence, quote Boganda. Could there be a better description of what we are witnessing today? But let's put it differently. Weren't they white, or rather, didn't they measure how white they were? So two, what is independence and do we want it? First point, the revolving door of independence. Independence was the keyword in the struggle of the great ancestors. Behind this flag, the immense majority of the people followed them. It was time to be done with contempt, with servitude, with frenzied exploitation. Time to refuse the whole ghastly colonial period. To have one's own country, one's own flag. Finally, to be master of one's own house. However, there were quite a few opponents of independence, particularly among the educated class, the potential cadres. The shortcut that best suited them was to attach themselves to the imperialist and to reap all the rewards of this attachment and to stay within the local chefferies. So in these countries where access to education was rigorously forbidden to the people, where only a few could accede to the status of middle class, it is obvious that said class, dissociated from the people and in the service of the imperialist, is infinitely corrupt and corruptible. And it remains obvious to this day. The middle class is the very node of the well-known desire for the West. On one side, the local potentate and the imperialist service. On the other, the construction of big, truly independent states. On the basis of this watchword, the great ancestors, Niobe, Lumumba, Nkrumah, Boganda, and so on, launched their appeal, often personally, often impelled by their verbal force alone, to the people. And the people answered them. We thus understand why, despite their different situations, Nkrumah, Niobe, and Lumumba all issue exactly the same watchword, immediate independence. But it is the colonialist and the imperialist who jumped at this watchword. Independence, of course, right away. We're giving you the gift of independence right away. We're even more immediate than you. In the Congo, Lumumba anticipated the formation of the first government in January of 1861. At that time, he's dead. Belgium offered independence on June 30th, 1960. 10 days later, on July 10th, the rich province of Katanga secedes, fomented by the Belgians. Troop planes, Belgian generals descend, and the country is set ablaze. Between Lumumba's first trip to Katanga in January of 1860, in handcuffs and with his face battered, before the Belgian dragged him out of prison to sit him down at the round table to see if they can corrupt him, and his second trip to Katanga, where he will be put to death, January of 1961, only a year has elapsed. In Cameroon, the masquerade of the independence ceremony takes place in January of 1861, while war is raging and supporters of independence are being tortured 2 streets away. Niobe, the leader of the Union of the Peoples of Cameroon, had been assassinated by French troops 2 years earlier, September 13, 1958, in the forest of the Bassa region in the south of Cameroon. His second in command, Félix Moumier, will be assassinated in Geneva by the French services 2 years later, on November 3, 1860. So independence everywhere meant aggravating and accelerating the destruction of the supporters of independence, putting them to death in cases where they hadn't already been killed. Independence meant the murder, crowned by the physical death of any potential African leader who proved not to be corruptible, of any hope of independence. This is where we still are today. This is what we are just beginning to recognize. So, two, we are often ridiculously naive. That is a quotation from Mao Zedong. The masses are clear-sighted, whereas we, the leaders, are often ridiculously naive. From the perspective of today, one cannot help applying this epithet to the great ancestors, the heroes and giants of the struggles for independence. They were just, they were clear-sighted, they served their peoples, they were right, and they were uncorruptible. But they proved to be ridiculously naive, and their naivety intensified the catastrophe. On the whole, there was still something in them of the tragic greatness of the Indian chiefs of North America, who signed treaties believing in their value because they saw the whites as men, also the reverse was not true. These chiefs saw the whites as men who ought therefore to behave like men, and they thought like men of the world. This happens again. Also, the African leaders had had time to get to know the whites. Also, they had the colonial experience behind them, which suggests that colonial experience was not enough to make them see clearly. In its brutality and horror, or was it thanks to them, it left too many things out of sight in the shadows. The motive for the whole business, its driving force, was not so clear. Fundamentally, we have to consider that the colonial relation as such is also a screen. Whence the element of the imaginary, so important especially in the history of the Congo, and which deserves perhaps for later lengthy study in its own right, from the Congo to France Fanon to the young girls of Abidjan today, who inject themselves with corticosteroids to whiten their skin. Whereas the cold monster of capital has neither odor nor color, and Piraeus is not a man. We therefore need to rethink colonialism as at once instrument and lure, including for its agents themselves. For sure, at that time, the illusion was derived by context of the world situation. The end of the Second World War, and with it, the figuring forth a new era. The weakening of the two great colonial empires, England and France, for the benefit of the United States, which, not having colonies, but wanting to open up new markets for itself, had little difficulty in declaring its support for the end of the colonial system. Also, the existence of the socialist camp, the counterpart of American power. All these factors contributed to the sense of an open space, of a possible play among nations capable of recognizing new nations. And there were big new nations, like India, for an example. And the Assembly of the United Nations bringing all of this together in the representation of a space of rational speech, judgment, and law. So there, our ancestor, they thus believed that they could rely on a space of law and avail themselves of a time for building. Besides, the goal, and already the result of a mobilization and a victory over the colonialists, was to go and express oneself in the forum of the United Nations. All this was conducive to the belief that the contradiction was indeed between the old, the colonial, and the new, the right to independence, the right of Africa to enter into the chorus of nations, as it said. To be more precise, all this led to the belief that the contradiction existed in itself, all things otherwise being equal. Therefore, Niobe devotes all his energy to arguing precisely and passionately in terms of law. While Lumumba asks, I quote, that we merely be permitted to rid ourselves of colonialism and imperialism without jeopardizing Belgian interest. Fundamentally, this was the idea that the world could recognize everyone, its division into two blocks, opening up space for the third term, the third world, non-aligned, and so on. where it would no longer be obligatory to think in antagonistic terms, but where, to the contrary, a time of peace and building was opening up beyond antagonism. Hence, the care they took to refute the accusation of communism, which in effect served to justify the immediate reconstitution of the space in antagonistic terms, those of a fight to the death. You should go on the internet and watch the video of Mesmer, a minister of De Gaulle and a member of the Académie Française, calmly declaring 30 years later that yes, his practice of bombing with napalm, of torture, of decapitated heads displayed at the gates of the village of Cameroon was entirely justified, since, I quote, these weren't independence fighters, these were revolutionaries. Independence, he said, was us. Independence has been indeed recaptured and annihilation. The United Nations immediately proves to be the tool of America, the spearhead of subjection. No time has been left for a process of disillusionment and for drawing up lessons of experience. Kwame Nkrumah relates how he took office in the governor's palace, where yesterday it was all congratulation and the handing over of power. There is not even a light bulb in the ceiling, or a chair, or a rim of paper, maybe in the corner a broken chair, though he understands that a much more terrible war is now declared. He writes his biography from his school years until the proclamation of independence. Then, immediately afterwards, he writes Africa Must Unite. Then, immediately after that, he writes on neocolonialism, which is a catalogue of the multinational companies that are squeezing the African continent with their tentacles, with their branches and their boards of directors, where the same people sit not only in multiple companies, but also in the ministries of the developed countries. When he writes his final book, Consciences, he is already in exile. Everything must be thought and picked up anew at a much deeper level, a much more radical one. Though three, picking up then two big mountains, not just one. Naivety, therefore, consisted in believing in a contradiction between colonialism and the desire for independence, all things otherwise being equal. The illusion was to imagine that the world, as it was, could recognize new states. The actual experience was that of a war aimed at the immediate annihilation of the supporters of independence in order to safeguard the imperialist stranglehold over the natural riches of Africa against any risk of interruption. But then, we must at least hear the lesson. Knowing that imperialism, but what is imperialism? Capitalism at its highest stage, none other than the definition given by Lenin in 1916. Imperialists then cannot do without zones of looting, of free looting. The end of the old colonial system having signified the opening up of looting zones to free competition among imperialists, which is why the United States proves so supportive of the much celebrated decolonization process, all the while cooperating so actively in the annihilation of the supporters of independence. Consequently, if this is true, there was not and there is not a path of development. Just as capitalism needs constant access to new labor power, exploitable at low cost, in order to counteract the downward trend of profit rates, and this really explains the move toward Asia, so it needs direct access to raw materials. And at its highest imperialist stage, the dismemberment of the world having been completed, competition is all about this access. We should note that the socialist camp, we could even say the progressive camp as a whole, played an extremely harmful role at the time by itself propagating the idea, which is to say the illusion, of a third way, of an autonomy of so-called national liberation struggles. And we should include as well the Chinese theory of three worlds with the idea of the relative autonomy of the level of the states, independence being assigned to the level of states, and so on. All this implies a topological view of the world with the center and the periphery, the struggles for anti-colonial liberation taking place on the periphery. The experience has proven that this was wrong, that exactly the opposite was the case. From the point of view of imperialism, in other words, of capitalism in its current stage, in other words, of the world today, Africa, the site for the looting of raw materials and for the fierce struggle to get the loot, is central. And Africa has to deal with the best in its heart. A young friend from the Central African Republic told me in why one there accuses Idriss Deby, but often stops at this point without going as far as Paris. Even so, everyone knows that Paris is the instigator and that what is at stake is the oil and diamonds in the north of the country. She told. But it is because we don't understand what France wants. What don't you understand? On the contrary, it seems to me that you have a very clear understanding of everything. Here is her answer. No, we know we're still colonized, but then they should just take their oil and their diamonds. But why kill poor peasants or sending them to death? That's what we don't understand. So what is to be understood then is that decolonization meant the passage from a relatively stable consensus as to the sharing of the world among imperialists as the result of the wars among them in the preceding period to a predominance of competition among them, which made Africa into their battlefield where they are now fighting through African intermediaries. This is why some people are compared to the lawless savagery of imperialism at a more advanced stage, one of greater rottenness in which the earth of Africa is only a space for brawling among bandits with the peoples of Africa as pawns in the struggle. But there is no going back, and imperialism is indeed the outcome of capitalism according to its own internal law. One must therefore manage to figure how to confront the best itself. This is why the great majority of Africans who have had this experience, who have seen and understood this, and this is itself a source of power, a great step forward, an end to drifting in dubious imaginary battles. while they are so pessimistic about any possibility of opening in any case in the short term. There is no independence and there will be none for quite a while, they say. And they are convinced at the same time that the decisive struggle will take place in the long term. And so, in order to achieve clarity on this point today, we propose from now on to call colonial anything having to do with the consensus among imperialists that Africa should remain a zone for looting, with concerted action and mutual aid to maintain this situation, and with the Western ideological consensus on this point, particularly by means of ad hoc international agencies, while imperialism, strictly speaking, is the looting itself and the looting war among the imperialists. And this is what makes Africa a battlefield, the battlefield of the intra-imperialist competition and war for access to raw materials. There is colonialism, the consensus and the agreement among imperialists that Africa should remain a looting zone. A good example is an attached article from the number one colonial rag, that is Le Monde in France, about the Congo. I quote their striking peroration. China, the United States, and Europe need the treasures housed in the country's subsoil. So they cannot lose interest in what is happening on its surface. That was the conclusion of an editorial of this newspaper, Le Monde. So as you can see, only the African continent, in particular the Congo, the object of such tender solicitude, must have no use of the riches of its subsoil. But colonialism is the envelope and the outer garment of imperialism in action. In other words, as the practice of looting and the fierce competitive struggle for the loot. Colonialism and imperialism are therefore inseparable. Colonialism is nothing more than the envelope of ideological consensus of imperialism as such. To take up the anti-colonial struggle in its first period was to go face to face with the best, without having anticipated it or even having known it in advance. In the end, this was the naivety. Today, however, after having had this experience, we would not be naive but guilty if we did not know how to learn lessons from the past and to think truly about the present. For we said, for the other continent, you will begin to exist once you have learned to put Africa at the center of your world. We can now say a bit more about this somewhat paradoxical statement. For, of course, the alleged thesis in the labor union style, which in the preceding period claimed a convergence of interest between the colonized people and the poor of the rich countries, has been proved to be a complete failure. Experience has proven that there was no such convergence, and at the time, Frantz Fanon very precisely denounced this thesis as the hoax that it was. What we can add is that in today's imperialism, not only is there no convergence of interest, but the interest, in fact, diverge radically. With the worsening of the competition for access to raw materials, poverty is increasing in the Western imperialist countries, and it will keep on increasing. Thwarted in its hunger for external expansion, capitalism can only regress to an older, 19th century type of configuration by excluding from the redistribution of what used to be called crumbs, larger and larger zones of the old metropolitan states, fewer and fewer crumbs. That is what we are witnessing today. And this clearly explains the almost unanimous colonial consensus that reigns supreme in a country like France, and which can only get worse in a time of crisis. It also explains the fascist-leaning subjectivity developing all over Europe, which also can only increase as time goes on. Not to see this would not be naivety, it would be pure madness. No convergence also means no unity negatively constituted around a supposed common enemy. Any supposed negative unity must quickly prove to be an illusion. Consequently, if you must put Africa at the center of your world, you must do so from a disinterested point of view. Indeed, it is precisely here, considering what has just been shown, that the touchstone of disinterestedness will lie. Now, any real politics, in other words, really incompatible with the existing capitalist order, is disinterested. For what is at stake is precisely not to submit to rule of private interest, but rather to intervene from another point of view, which we could call the point of view of humanity as a whole, or the point of view of equality, the point of view of the right of everyone to exist. Every man is a man. It is from this point of view that we can say that your relation to Africa serves as a touchstone of your capacity to be free or to make yourself an effective exception to the existing order. Let us clarify another point. Serving the interest of capital or serving the interest of humanity? Serving private interest only being a variant of the first term. But this having been said, of course, it is the duty of everyone to survive, in other words, to make his or her place in the world as it is, while avoiding as much as possible hurting others in the process. So the whole question is thus to know, on the one hand, if one knows it. According to a phrase of Martin Singer, who was the leader of the underground forces of the Union of the Peoples of Cameroon in the Bamileke region, which is quoted in the book Cameroon. I quote, at the end of the terrible summer of 1960, the underground troops are attacked ferociously, and the chief of staff of the Army for the National Liberation of Cameroon has ordered the exhausted elderly women and children to return to the secured villages on the model of the French army in Algeria. For it has become impossible for Singap to keep alive in the backwoods thousands of families exposed to bombing and to the general precariousness of the life of the underworld. So, I quote, in a huge meeting of militants organized by the UPC on September 5, 1960 in Mangi, from 7 p.m. until midnight, at which no fewer than 1,500 people were present, a leader explained Singap's order to his comrades. All of you are going to return to your native villages. The enemies of our country will take you for supporters, but, I quote, it is you who will know who you are. So know who you are. That's my first point. Know, moreover, which is even more important, whether that is all you will do, or whether you will do something in addition, something beyond. And it is on this point that we arrive at real politics, that is to say, politics incompatible with the capitalist order, that is to say, communist politics. Politics is already communist insofar as it is in addition, insofar as it is, as we used to say, free labor. Communism, in other words, the point of view of all humanity, finally depends on the extra half hour that one can snatch from an already busy day, when one does not participate in the bourgeois world. To understand this thing that looks so simple, but that it is not so easy to put into practice, is really to learn the lesson of the past century. With this point, we get the question of activism, question of politics. So, third part, what is to be done? First, let us agree on the basic thesis. If they are true, we must speak them, affirm them, in other words. As the great ancestor wished, there must be big states. This has become ever truer insofar as Africa is more than ever the looting zone of global imperialism and has become the stake in the competition among imperialist groups and the site of their battle. It definitely takes a big state to be able to expropriate a multinational company and to kick out of one's home the Taj gangs in its pay. Big states as a proposal, a watchword, a line to follow, an objective. This means states that completely transcend borders of ethnicity, religion, and nationality in the narrow sense of the term. That will be one of their great virtues. And it is moreover a direction for work that can begin immediately. Completely separate political question from all question of identity, which we will posit come under the heading of free association, adding that states will guarantee this freedom, but that the politics that interest us, intervening on question of general interest and from the point of view of general interest, is indifferent to question of identity, is diagonal to them, and does not exist on the same register, except in intervening to require states to guarantee the right of free association and even to encourage it in every way possible. So this politics goes completely against the contemporary trends that preach, on the contrary, that politics simply is question of identity. And also against the worn-out discourses along the lines of everything is political and so on. Discourses by the same people who, not afraid as there be contradiction, also complain that political organization victimize their identity. No, politics is about concerning oneself with political questions and not with the rest. Let us be clear. From the point of view of politics, which needs energetic subjects, the more of the West there is, that is, the more singular identities there are, the more ramified and solid symbolic constructions there are, the better things will be. Imperialism needs individuals who are defeated and exhausted, which is why it makes sure that, beginning in their most tender years, children are forbidden any possibility of symbolic construction. In so doing, imperialism threatens to destroy any civilization and gets busy making good on the threat. For us, exactly the opposite is the case. the more subjects there are and the more singularities there are, the more humanity there will be and the more chances for humanity there will be. Mobilizing urban cultures, music, language, testimonies and memories, going to place of worship and so on. This does not contradict the work of political unification, quite the contrary. But it is not at all the same thing. Claiming that it is the same thing or that one should rule over the other would be catastrophic. Unity around and through political proposal and watchwords is an essential term. And it is a goal for work that is always possible here and now, whatever the scale of this work may be. It requires maintaining that political unification is a process independent of questions of identity and indifferent to them, constructing itself on the basis of its own terms, perhaps in sympathy with questions of identity, but in any case, at a distance from them. Where to find the strength to construct and impose these big states? Certainly not at the level of the states or of their personnel. On this point, the experience of the great ancestor is definitive. Their efforts at this level all failed. But more generally, that is the lesson of the whole 20th century, which we can sum up in this somewhat crude way. Affairs of state are much too serious to be left in the care of states. As we know, this was precisely the call issued by Mao Zedong to Chinese youth at the beginning of the Cultural Revolution. Get mixed up in affairs of the states, which again, it's not so easy. On this point, then, we can maintain that African consciousness is ahead of the game in the sense in which any conscientious African, as Lenin would have said, knows that nothing is to be done at the level of the state, since at this level, the only alternative is corruption or death. The whole question is to follow through with the consequence of this knowledge. A first consequence is certainly not to expect anything from any position within state or international institutions. But we must go further. An essential point is situating oneself completely outside the existing corrupt states is to succeed in keeping one's distance from elections. Elections, as we know, are a means of division and of crushing. The purpose of election is to involve people in the naming of a subordinate and servile state personnel. At best, they announce a period of corruption for very little, often for a simple t-shirt, of sterile division, since there is nothing really at stake in them, and thus of the paralysis of the peoples. At worst, they open up periods of confrontation that are all the more atrocious for being pointless. Elections have been a dreadfully pernicious way of attacking the supporters of independence. And experience has shown that it is not easy to escape them. The most striking example with the most disastrous consequences is undoubtedly that of the elections organized in 1956 by the French government in Cameroon. Previously, the Union of People of Cameroon, the party of Niobe and Moumié, the only serious and truly established party, had been prohibited. It therefore could not run its own candidates. What was to be done under these conditions? Accepting these falsified elections and relying on moderate spokespeople like Sopo Priso, who will immediately play their own game and disburden themselves from the commitments they have made, or boycotting the elections. It is because it found itself squeezed in this double bind at the submission and the risk of accepting the formation of a phony government or a boycott which would have meant entering into antagonism, that the UPC, in fact, lost the initiative and found itself committed, in spite of itself, to a rash and defensive war. Same thing in the Congo, same thing more recently with Aristide's party in Haiti. We can truly say that once real independent forces are constituted, the election function in the hands of destruction, allowing the initiative and to hasten the antagonism according to a time scheme determined by them. So then, let us propose to agree on the line that we will call that of indifference to elections. The word indifference is essential, and we will take our starting point in proposing two watchwords of indifference. First, indifference that does not preclude sympathy toward the process of identification. Second, antipathy, but above all, indifference toward electoral processes. Indifference here being the important point to apply and to win. Let it be understood that we are neither concerned with nor interested in elections. What defines this line is, in fact, an immediate stake, which is to suggest that we not talk about, consequently, that we not become divided over names, but only about contents, proposal, watchwords. We will claim that this is enough to begin. To begin what? Investigating, working among people, the people. Must we pick up the question of independence where it was left off? Must our goal be the construction of big states? What do you think of these proposals? Here, objections, stories, example, enumeration of obstacles. In this case, we propose the discussion of two watchwords of indifference are going to proliferate. Perhaps they can take written form, that of a tract, which would then be presented for discussion. A meeting could be called. At that point, new watchwords will emerge, small ones, intermediate ones, objectives putting this work of unification into action. A small work, certainly, patient, tiny. The initial thesis will become increasingly refined, reshaped, ramified, depending upon place, circumstances, the battles that need to be won. The work of arms, invisible, bringing neither rewards nor fame, the work of the Olmol, except that here the image is less one of digging in order to undermine the edifice than to construct. To construct what? Nothing other than an independence. For we will maintain that independence, as we have seen, is not an affair of state, cannot be entrusted to states. For whom and where then, if not to the people? What is independence, if not a politicized people capable of imposing its decisions? This is why we can say that independence, as the UPC saw and practiced it in Cameroon, even without grasping its ultimate political consequences. This is why we must pick up where it left off. Independence is nothing other than, I quote, the proceedings, the process of independence. In Basa language, Ngar Kunde. That means you will know who you are. Thus, as Mao Zedong used to say, to investigate a problem is to solve it. Politics consists of proposing theses and of putting them to work and into discussion, of addressing the problem to be solved, and of continuing, of beginning and of continuing, of following through the process of holding onto the thread. Who will do it? Anyone, anyone and everyone can do it, those who decide to do it. Certainly, those who have a little more time have a particular responsibility. How are we going to do anything, a comrade used to say to me, when in the Congo, for example, you have to devote all your time and energy to finding whatever you can eat today. Particular responsibility falls to those who know how to read and can read for others, who know how to write and thus how to take notes and write them up, who can travel and so on. In other words, the well-known question of the intellectuals. We can no longer hope that, as Amilcar Cabral used to say, the petite bourgeoisie will commit suicide as a class in order to put itself in the service of its people and of the peoples. More than ever today, the petite bourgeoisie, the literate class, constitutes the bulk of the corrupted, the servile personnel. The responsibility falls to those who are one and another, to singular subjects. When the connection to the masses, the idea of going to the people, becomes itself a mass phenomenon, it means that something is going to happen. This is the 19th century Russia, or in a smaller and closer version, the movement of going to work in the factories in France just before 1968. So it is also something that already participates in movement, carrying with it the energy and the ambiguity of what makes movement possible and interrupts itself in the exhaustion of its contradiction. This was often the beginning without any follow-up, because the predominant fantasy was that of going there but nothing after, because in the last analysis, what was really, really involved was a narcissistic project, because the theme of connection is a theme of movement, at once strong and ambiguous. This is an absolutely necessary term, a sine qua non condition for beginning, but it is not a sufficient term for politics. The political term, the militant one, is to begin and to continue, and then it is equality as the experience of the process and of contents. To put it differently, what is available to us today is a method. This method is, properly speaking, the heritage of Maoism, whose content is in no way reducible to the idea of mass labor, that is the recruitment and the beginning. It is a method for continuing, in other words, for trying out through the rigor of the investigation and the realization of its consequences by means of new proposals, new workshops, new citizens, and so on. So the experience that we can continue. Okay, so this text presents itself as a proposal for beginning and for continuing. That's all.
Thank you, Dr. Pinter. Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a super paper. And I must say that it's a politically charged paper with activist agendas in mind and the ways in which Lenin and Mao have been mobilized. So let's continue, let's begin and continue. Questions? We'll have... Question, how much time are we left for question and answer? Okay, 15 minutes, so we have still reach the
I just read the latest edition of Wretched Leader of Bannon. Latest edition has an introduction by Tommy Bob.
Oh, I
yes. Well, that's kind of what I wanted to find out, how people put the perception that this Tommy Bob is a man. He's saying that if Fanon was alive today, he would do what he did, looking at I guess it's not, but nationalism, this critique of nationalism of states as the solution to emancipation. What do you think about that? Considering that, I guess.
What do you mean by election nationalism?
Well, right, that's the meaning of Kabbalah, I suppose, is a post-colonial.
Can you make sure it's in great to the microphone? Because we have to pull this in on the
that there are no national independence at all. At all. They have no independency. Not at all. So we cannot speak about nationalism because there are no.
The contradiction exists within the nation. Nation state. That's what got me to think of this one, because I'm thinking about reporting and here's a nation state and I don't know, region, other ways of region or history together, other ways of organizing. That's all, just
stating. I don't like very much those post-colonial theories because they do as such something was finished and we are in a new era. And I think it's not true at all because it's what I wanted to relate because there was first time for colonialism but now we are in a second time.
Sorry.
The process of independence has failed because people who wanted independence, they were destroyed all over. So the question is, again with colonialism, only we know that colonialism is not only the oppression by one particular state. It's not France owing this part and so on. But anyway, it's colonialism. So, how they speak post-colonial, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And also, you know, the people from Cameroon, when they spoke about independence, they spoke about the process of independence. And I think that means, for one part, the proceeding of unification of the people and so on. But by the other hand, it was the process, the trial, of the colonization, and that had it hasn't been made, never. So it's not beyond us. It's devant, above. It's above. It can't be done at all. So that's the reason I don't like this post-colonial statement. Okay. Okay.
Yes.
Test.
Your question.
I was struck by how many very important and new formulations there were in your paper. Really exciting and interesting ones. Like, yes, you know, we're still connected to the period of immediate post-colonialism, but we're finding you've given a new definition. And you've given a new definition, even more excitingly, to independence. That's very different than the notion of independence that people had back in 1960. I even love, right before your talk, something little and simple that you said. You said politics, I'm not sure I got this right, but I love it. You said politics is expert work for free. I just love that. It's a whole different slant into communism. And it's a remarkable little turn of the phrase. But I think your talk is remarkably loaded with important formulations that we can learn from.
But I think that's interesting. Why? Because it's my own propaganda. Why? How it was done. The story is interesting because in the beginning, in 2000, I wanted to do something about antiretroviral treatment in Africa and so on. So we write a petition. And a lot of people signed this petition, but no one newspaper in France wanted to print. We could print this simple petition asking that France give for free antiretroviral treatment to his former colonies. So what can we do if no one newspaper wants to publish this petition? So at that point, I have to decide with one of my friends, so you must be two. That's a necessity. We will begin again as we were Maoist militants before. We know how to do that. We must begin to write a paper and go on the street, give it to the passant-by and speak about. So it's what we have done. And first experience, we went on the marketplace in Paris, and with a lot of French petit bourgeois people, so we gave our paper, and we experienced that when they understood about what we are speaking, they make a world around not to see us. They didn't want to hear about that. So it was an experience. And then we had to move in other place, in suburb, and so on and so on. From one place to one place, we meet another paper. We meet another people, we write with him another paper, okay? And then we finished in a place in Paris which is a market for African people. And we went there almost 10 years, every Saturday. And, okay, we speak with people, and people, they like to tell us their own history, how it happened that they came to France, how many times they traveled from their country to France, and so on. So we began to write a little newspapers. Very from these stories. You do understand me? From the story, this guy who came from Ivory Coast to France, it took to him 4 years to come from Ivory Coast to France, and why he had to leave the country, what he decided to leave his proper country, what he learned during this very terrible journey, and so on. So we have we propose one thesis and one after the other, okay? And of course, in this process, myself, I could learn that I don't know anything about Africa. And it was a very interesting experience. But for example, the war in Cameroon, I didn't know anything about. And as the last of the leaders of this Union of People of Cameroon was hanged up, it was in 72. We were militants in France at that moment. We were making protests and so on, but we didn't even knew what happened in Cameroon. So I began to read. For example, I one time at the hospital, I was reading a book by Umyobe, and the book was on my desk. And so one of my patients is a guy from Cameroon. I knew him 15 years. So I asked him, "Do you know Umyobe?" And he answered me, "Oh yes, it was my uncle." So I know this guy 15 years, but here you can imagine what is the real gap between us and African people, because I didn't know until this time anything about Umyobe, and he knows that I don't know anything. You understand me? He knows that there is no reason to speak with people in France, because they know all that we don't know anything. So it's very fruitful when we begin to speak together. It's what I wanted. Very fruitful because we begin to understand which is the gap and so on. So that's the way it took maybe 10 years to do this work, because every Saturday I go with my friend on that place and then we speak, okay, what we will write next Saturday after we have hear what we hear today. You don't understand me?
Yes,
so this kind of work. But I think this kind of work, this is very fruitful, and it's my, because the questions are so big and we are very small, but I think it's very important to recognize that if you do such a work, you get extremely important things, I think. You can understand and propose input, and what I told that, it's just that what people tell to me. For example, a guy, we wrote an article with him. He told, "No, there is no independence in Africa." It's my assertion. Why? And then. So I think it's why I think that this method, I call it Maoist method, that is, go and made the investigation and speak with people. Okay, and today we found this proposition, we write it, and again, what are you thinking about we have written today? So another guy or woman will say, "Oh, yeah." So you must continue. It's why I told you can continue. That's, I think, the most important thing. So even if you have a very small group, it's possible, by my opinion.
Thank you. We can still continue. We have another 10 minutes.
Yeah. And there was a cab driver who said, "Well, what are you all about, you people?" And we said, "Well, we're here for a philosophy conference." He said, "Oh, I've seen these posters around town." So he said, "Well, what is that really about?" So I said, "Well, Alain Badiou, he's here to talk to us about his life. He's here to talk to us about communism." He goes, "Communism, I was waiting for you to say that." And it turns out that he has this whole history from Eritrea, where he was trained in Rostov-on-Don. Now, I'm not sure how revolutionary a place that was, but he was so excited, and he was so engaged with talking to us about the nature of the conference from just this kind of encounter, this simple, basic encounter in the backseat of his taxi.
Okay. Yeah. Go ahead.
I was really struck by your formulation of your reading of independence as a really a nominal false independence, sort of gifted, quote unquote, to these various African nations as a guise for really a more pernicious form of capitalist imperialism, and really at the behest in some ways of the United States through the United Nations, and that accompanied with these false illusory elections where the choices between two sides that or more sides that are essentially just going to submit to further capitalist invasion. And I was struck, the analogy is not perfect, but it strikes me as a really interesting echo on a much grander scale of what happened just about 100 years earlier in the United States with the abolition of slavery, which again is a sort of nominal independence given to the African-American former slaves, where they say, okay, now you're independent, you're free, but the freedom, and which also also what came along with that is, at least for African-American men, the ability to vote, the right to vote. But it's again, it's totally nominal. It's totally, the freedom is the freedom to submit to a different form of wage slavery now. And again, the ability to, the right to vote is not the right to vote for someone who has your interests in mind, not for someone who's a part of your community, but again, for the people that are in power and that are still maintaining the same control of you, but just in a different form than previously. And I just thought that was a really interesting kind of, that this is something that happens in the United States in the 1800s, in the 1860s and 70s, and then happens again on the world stage with Europe and the United States and Africa, but just on a much grander scale and almost 100 years later. I just wanted to say that I found that to be a really interesting kind of echo and in many ways very disturbing echo, because we see these same sort of horrific processes being repeated and growing more and more violent and sort of all-encompassing.
Thank you. Do you want to respond to that? Or any other? Yeah, still. Go ahead.
I'm wondering about the relationship between your conception of pan-Africanism, pan-African unity, and big states. Because at one level, pan-African unity suggests to me a conception or an ethic of community and solidarity and reciprocity among African people. But big states comes with the language, to me, comes with the language of social contract theory and a relationship between citizens and the state, and comes with the understanding of communism as an ideal that involves a withering away of the state. Why is a citizen, African state relationship superior to something like an ethic of cosmopolitanism, world citizenship?
What'd she say, at the end?
The last sentence?
Can you repeat a little? I mean,
yes.
Make it a little precise.
Okay. Or just the end. So why is a model of pan-African unity and solidarity among African people, how is it supposed to be consistent with a big African state, as opposed to a region without borders? I can see the value of eliminating the borders and therefore eliminating nationalism, but the idea of a state comes with a lot of conceptual baggage.
Yes.
About power, domination, and protection, defensive.
Yes, I understood.
Sorry.
The question, yes. And of course, you could say, as are you communist, I don't like states. That's true, but that's a point. But another point is that we need states also. That is a contradiction, but it's real. And at the moment, who is destroying states is the imperialist forces in Africa. They are destroying states every day.
Every day you can see new state, smaller, new borders. And that means pure free looting. They do what they want. So for sure, we need states. And it's a contradiction, but you need state. The question is, who is constructing such states, who is ruling the state, and so on. But you have to keep in mind this contradiction. And now in Africa, people, they need states. They don't have, you know, and don't having a state is the more terrible situation, because you are thrown for any disorder, any violence. Somebody, you know, like in the Middle Age, one troop come today, another come today, take you from your house, and so on. So people think, okay, and once we had a small, like a small meeting with people from Congo, and the discussion was, what is a real state? How we can stay? We were written them. Once second point was, you do have juridical apparatus, justice. You must have a law. That's the second point. They said, first of all, let's speak about the prisoners. That was that. So justice, that was point. Third point, it must be that the richness of the country could be used by the people of the country. It was the third point. And the fourth point, it was health, school, roads. The state must assure, give us health, schools, and roads. And it was the fourth point. And the fifth, yes, we really want to pay taxes. There must be taxes, because you don't have a state without paying taxes. And then we asked, and what about the elections? They said, no, it's not the point. The point, so the question was to, we could discuss among people, do you agree with the question of what could be a real state? And we propose those four points, and what is your opinion about, and so on. Such discussion. And then we ask, so what about Congo? In the time of Mobutu, they said Congo in the time of Mobutu, only the first point. He keeps borders. And right now, no points. Zero. So no state at all. And that's true. There is no state at all in Congo. But life is very terrible in Congo. So the question to consider is, okay.
This will be our last question, actually, or because I'm sure you're tired too. And, okay. All right. So maybe another two questions.
Thank you. I'll try.
We'll end at four.
I'll try to be very brief. I appreciate very much your coming here and speaking with us and sharing your paper. I have an appreciation and a question, both of which I think are brief. The appreciation, I think, goes to the way you discussed what I thought of as the political situation in France around the question of Pan-African unity. And your deployment of the question of the passion for ignorance, which I appreciated very much. Specifically, when you're talking about the denial in self-evidence of something, of an order from which you derive from some, perhaps your friends from Africa, a man is a man in the bullshit of humanitarian ideology. I thought that was a very powerful provocation, and I appreciated the subtlety of it, which is a very difficult thing, I find, to do, and I hope others were provoked by it as well. My question is very specific. It's about empire and childhood. Children are forbidden the possibility of symbolic construction, right? I wanted to ask if you could just briefly say something further to help us understand the point you're making there.
This is, okay, that's the experience in France for myself with children from immigrant descendants, because they have no right to represent themselves because the denial of all what happened to their family and fathers, just that. So I think that it's the reason why they don't want to go to school, simply. They don't want to go to school because in school, because they have no means to construct themselves. Because if you have no right to represent what happened to your father or to your grandfather and so on, how could you construct yourself as a young boy? That's the reason. And for an example, just last week, it was the Mondial football and so on. Okay. So some mayor in France, they decide you have no right to have an Algerian flag. Why? So it's oppression against young people. There are a lot of young people in France. They are of Algerian descendants. Their father, they were involved in the Algerian war. They have no right to know about that, to have pride. So I think a young boy or girl, especially a young boy, he must can be proud about his father. So just that. And it's not allowed in France for those young people coming from Africa or from Arabic descendants, because Algerian war, you can say anything. What happened in Africa, anything. When you go to school, there is nothing in the books, history, and so on. And even you have no right to have your Algerian flag on the street. Such things I had in mind, so.
So we're going to conclude now, and the questions that remain can be posed to Dr. Winter one-on-one. And I'm sorry, there's some folks that have deadlines, okay? Okay, so we're going to meet up. We can actually move from here and go, but we're going to meet up at 555 City Flats Lounge, and then we'll walk to where we're going to meet tonight, okay? Thank you all very much. Thank you, Dr. Winter. Appreciate it. Thanks.
Again. Okay.